props for using Yoder. I certainly identify as an Anabaptist, so if any of you are theology majors or anything like that, that'll maybe help you understand my argument. Props for naming the doublespeak of the U.S. military and for drawing on the prophetic tradition of saying, woe to you who say peace, peace, where there is no peace. I just wanted to just honor those points in the beginning. It's important to say out front that my approach is not an economic analysis in the usual sense of the term. Rather, what I'm bringing today is a critique arising from a theological vision. I'm going to interrupt myself and just give you the title, which kind of will function as a table of contents that you can kind of track with me on. I'm sorry, I don't have anything to put up here on the screen. The title, which we won't get to all of the table of contents, which is the title, but the title is Turning from Mammon to Manna, Capitalism as Heresy, Technology of Fracture, and Crypto-Fascism. I understand it's a bit inflammatory, but it's like an inflammation as pedagogical technique, maybe. Okay, so the first sentence again. It's important to say out front that my approach is not an economic analysis in the usual sense of the term. Rather, what I'm bringing today is a critique arising from a theological vision. I won't be getting into statistics, talking about capitalism's inability to deliver the goods, and I will certainly not be putting forth an alternative economic vision such as socialism or anything else. But please understand, I don't at all mean to suggest that I'm avoiding economics. To the contrary, my aim is to point out that theology, or more specifically, the narrative tradition of the Bible, is itself a form of economic discourse in its own right. Perhaps a stronger way to put it is to state the converse, which is that economic proposals such as free market capitalism and socialism, because of the claims they make and the matters they wish to deal with, are themselves already in theological territory, making religious claims whether they know it or not. To understand what I mean here, it helps to think about the origin of the term economy. Wendell Berry likes to point out that the title to one of his most well-known books, Home Economics, is redundant. In doing so, he draws our attention to the Greek origins of the term economy, bringing together oikos, or household, and nemos, which roughly refers to distribution. We have the term oikonomia and its relatives, referring to the ensemble of decisions and practices that pertain to a people's collaborative use, distribution, and exchange of various things such as time, creation's gifts such as food, medicine, clothing, and building materials, as well as skills, tools, land, and more. Much more could be said about the genealogy of the term, but what is germane for us to understand right now is that the term economics is about dealing with the real conditions of our lives. It can be, but is not necessarily, a science. Sometimes, as my friends with children know, or who have gardens, or both, it is an art as much as a science, sometimes more of an improvisational dance than a predetermined calculus. If we have time, when I near the end, perhaps we'll venture further into Wendell Berry's thought. But to summarize the primary point in what I've made just now, let me say this. All economic proposals grow on theological rootstock. In other words, all economic proposals unavoidably usher forth from assumptions about reality that are theological, whether consciously or unconsciously. If economics is about communities, is about how communities of people, small or large, engage in the exchange and distribution of goods and services, such as the fruits of the land, otherwise known as natural resources, skills and services such as home building, medical services, tool making, and so forth, then it cannot be stressed enough that from the perspective of discipleship commitment, economics is so obviously connected to ecclesial vocation that the church can in no way try to think economics apart from theology. To put it a bit more succinctly, economy can only be properly thought theologically. So I'll say it once again. The tradition that runs from Jesus back through the prophets to Moses and Exodus is an economic discourse in its own right. And economic proposals such as free market capitalism, interventionist forms of capitalism, as well as socialism, are offering rival narrative construals of how best we are to order the exchange dynamics of our lives. Capitalism as heresy. Capitalism must be understood as a religion. Far from being some sort of religiously neutral calculation of exchange, the chief architects and contemporary proponents of capitalism are quite open about the philosophical underpinnings of their proposals. Like most religious traditions, it carries certain doctrinal assumptions about who we are and how the world works. Though much of my argument may be polemical and inflammatory, I mean this in the most serious sense. It never ceases to surprise me that evangelicals who so thoroughly oppose religious narratives such as Islam and Buddhism fail to see that capitalism too is offering a rival vision of God and the world. Why the preference for resisting those stories and not others? The cosmological vision of capitalism, brought to us by folks like Adam Smith, Thomas Malthus, and contemporaries like Milton Friedman and Thomas Friedman, would have us believe and act as if the earth were fundamentally characterized by scarcity, by lack. This, of course, is where the chief capitalist doctrine of competition comes from. According to this view, people's natural awareness of scarcity, along with their associated inclination to meet their own needs, is what stimulates and sustains both their consumption and production. People will naturally offer what they have, whether that is services or goods, in exchange for whatever it is they want or need. In order to acquire what they want and need, they must have the means to do so, and consequently, they must offer their services or goods in a competitive way, so as to ensure that they themselves get patronized rather than others. This kind of competition is seen as a natural state of affairs in capitalist religion. This primal ontology of scarcity, or what we could call the doctrine of original deficiency, or lack, ushers forth from a fundamentally adversarial account of sociality. I'll have to come back to this problem of normalized relational antagonism later, because first I want to make sure that you see the juxtaposition I'm setting up. The religion of capitalism sees scarcity as written into the very fabric of this world's existence. The radical traditions in the Bible, however, see the world as a place characterized by abundance, ushered forth from the infinite plenitude of God's heart, from the superabundance of the self-giving God. This is not to suggest that the biblical narrative has nothing to say about scarcity. It certainly does. But scarcity, according to our tradition, is the result of sin and a world held captive to the principalities and powers under the fall. Scarcity is the result of an inappropriate relation to the earth, overconsumption, refusal to share, and rejection of Sabbath. And yet a Christological understanding of the world would insist that in the midst of this present age of scarcity, there is a better word to be spoken. For in Christ, we are to be caught up in palingenesis, a return to our origins, a recovery of righteous livelihood, where principalities and powers have been unmasked, and we are empowered by the Spirit to inhabit the earth as we ought, to collaborate rather than compete, to give freely without need for exacting return. We are set free to see our work as co-creation, not as a service we offer in order to get something in return, but as a fundamentally liturgical act, that is, as an offering that participates in the restoration of the world. Getting money for it is boorishly beside the point. In addition to these ontological assumptions about scarcity and competition, the capitalist narrative also offers what can only be referred to as a soteriological proclamation. For a while, I used to say that capitalism is particularly pernicious because it masquerades as a religiously neutral, purely economic system, all the while robbing us of theological imagination and discipleship creativity. To some extent, I still think that, but over the last few years, I've become increasingly disturbed by the overt spiritual language used by capitalists. Far from covertly offering a salvation history, one of capitalism's founding fathers, Adam Smith, famously invited us to trust, quote, trust in the invisible hand of the market. This sort of metaphorical admonition used to be the art form of rabbis and desert fathers. Not now. A Barnes & Noble perusal of the Free Marketeer's gallery of metaphors will betoken a veritable great awakening where mammon is the new healer in big tent revivals. This notion of the invisible hand results in a sort of packaging of salvation history on one hand and theology of mission on the other. It is capitalism's answer to religious questions like, what is the problem? How do we get through it? And how do we change the world to benefit everyone? It answers these questions by suggesting that there is violence and corruption and poverty because the market has not yet been set free to do what it can do, which is balance power, maximize human freedom, and usher in justice and peace. It suggests that we remove all state intervention so that the market can work its magic, and it instructs us to become partners of the poor by making more money so that we can then generate creative responses to third world hunger, homelessness, and addiction. To use the common capitalist jargon, this trickle-down effect is what we must devote our energies to. The flow of transformative healing power moves from top to bottom. But please hear the juxtaposition. The world will not be set right through sustainable investing, capitalism with a face, or Christian CEOs. It is set right through Christ crucified, through the people of Pentecost offering their lives in the places where the world is in pain, bearing witness to the resurrection, and through the coming of the kingdom. Following Timothy Gorringe, we should point out that uniquely in world literature, in 1 Corinthians 1, someone speaks of the weakness of God and ventures a dialectical account of power. Power remains agency, but not that of one who is stronger than anyone else or who has the leverage of capital, but a power that overcomes through weakness. The crucifixion of Jesus reveals the illegitimacy of the power of the strong and privileged, including capitalist forms of benevolent trickle-down. The life we were created for is accessible not through the grand philanthropic endeavors of the business savvy, but through the fire of emancipation lit only by the God of Exodus and New Exodus. In addition to capitalism's ontology of scarcity and violence, its salvation history of mammon's guiding providence, and disciplines of accumulation for the common good, capitalism also offers a vision of Catholicity. Globalization is the process by which the world is supposedly knit together tightly in the interests of trade. Since, according to the capitalist vision of the good, trade is what is needed for prosperity, and since in the modern world only modern, industrialized, technologically advanced nations can engage in trade, development becomes necessary for the world's people to become free, for African nations to enjoy their inalienable right to the latte. But of course, in order for so-called underdeveloped countries to develop, they must offer what they do have in exchange for what they don't. Trees, perhaps, or access to oil. It's a familiar story. Once they embark upon this process and are converted to the capitalist vision of the good life, flowing with Coca-Cola, Big Macs, and pop music, they want more. More of everything, really. The slow, methodical, and totalizing erasure of local culture has begun, and the global village emerges. Third world peoples then need more development, which, as you know, requires them to borrow. This is what started happening primarily toward the close of the 1960s, as cheap loans were offered to the global south. But when interest rates rose, these countries found themselves trapped, effectively debtors forever to northern banks, paying back the initial loans hundreds of times over, but never able to get free of the interest. In the name of peace, growth, and freedom, a global trade language encircles the earth. People replace their heirloom vegetables with scientifically improved seed. Ancient instruments are forgotten in favor of amps and beatboxes. Naturally occurring colors on traditional clothing are ignored under the powerful neon lights of advertising. But notice the juxtaposition. Catholicity, or in other words, the recovery of oneness in a world divided by sin and abuse of power, is not occurring through this kind of global village. The biblical vision of peace, of Catholicity, is not a vision of homogenization, not a sustained obliteration of difference or universalizing sameness. To the contrary, the biblical vision is of harmonious difference. Indeed, the gospel not only permits difference, but protects it, as is forcefully demonstrated by the Apostle Paul's insistence on the Ecclesia as a Jew plus Gentile community, where only death-dealing cultural residues are cast aside, while the rich diversity of cultural distinctiveness is maintained.